Hello, welcome to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. Busy couch today, nearly all thespians or associated artists. And in the first half of the show, I'm joined on the sofa by Jerry McCrudden and Joe Neary. Thank you for coming in, both of you.
Thanks for having us here.
Yeah. They said in unison.
How do you find the time to come and do things like this when you're actually about to go into production with something?
Well, because if you put on a play, if you put on a production, if you don't have an audience, why do it? So
Exactly. Also, thanks for explaining that to me. Yes, please take note. This is good publicity. You're very well out of it. Let's start with you, Jerry. You're very much part of the New Venture Theatre here in Brighton,
yes,
and have been since it was upgraded and lifted to a whole new level, really, with two performance spaces.
Yes.
And that took up a lot of time, but actually you're a director.
I direct a lot. I mean, it wasn't my profession. I was a diplomat, but I then became, when I took early retirement, I decided, I like directing, you know. Don't like acting too much because I can never remember the lines.
Let's face it, looking at the world's political stage, being a diplomat is in fact performing, isn't it?
Well, it is. You go in and you work the room.
Yeah.
And you've got a message to tell when you go to meet officials and stuff like that. So it's, there's a lot of similarities, I have to say. Let's say the transition was not difficult.
But you enjoy this as much as diplomacy, or?
I think I enjoy this better,
yeah,
because I look at the diplomatic world at the moment, like all of us, and I despair. You know, I have three spare bricks sitting by my television, which I'm ready to throw sometimes, but so I'm glad it's someone else's responsibility now. But I'm really enjoying directing at the NVT. And as you say, there's been a lot of upgrading at the NVT for the last 8-10 years. A lot of money has gone into it. And we were saying earlier, in the arts, it's very difficult, isn't it, to get funding, and there's not so much money going around, and it's a constant battle to put on shows and to keep spaces.
Well, you must both find this. I mean, the whole thing of having to find and apply for funding is a full-time job in its own right. I mean, if you've got to apply for funding, how do you find the time to perform?
Well, I got someone to help me apply for funding because it seems to be an art form in itself, doesn't it?
They are terrifying, those documents, aren't they?
Yeah. I had a friend help me out, so yeah. But it's a lot of work getting funding, and a lot of work once you've got it. You don't get money for nothing, do you? But it's a wonderful
opportunity.
Anything
for nothing these days, unfortunately.
No.
Apart from coming here and being on the sofa with me, and this is absolutely free.
And the Arts Council grants have more or less dried up. I don't know anybody who's had an Arts Council grant, but I suppose they are around. You know, they've only so much money, obviously. But we try.
We find a way to express ourselves, don't we, Jerry?
Well, creative people do. Creative people do. You know, now, it's an audience of one, even.
The production that opens at the weekend is Gabriel. Tell us a little bit about play.
Well, it's based in... It's by Maura Buffini, a British writer. It was written about 20 years ago, and it's been on the London stage and in New York and Philadelphia. And it tells the story of a forgotten period of British history. We were saying earlier about the Channel Islands, British Channel Islands, were taken over by the Germans during the Second World War for practically the whole length of the war, 1940 to 1945, because the British government decided, oh, we can't defend them, so we'll just leave them. So we just walked out.
And so we abandoned them.
They were abandoned. Abandoned is the word, I think, that best describes it. And this story tells of this family who've been evicted from their big house, as it were, by the German officers, and they've been removed to a cottage on the estate. And it's four women, four very good female parts, I have to say, and they live in this house, and a bit problematical, their relationships, but that makes the play and the dialogue much more interesting in the storyline. And then one night, a body is washed on the shore, naked. You don't see anything, but the body is naked.
So disappointing.
So they can't tell who he is. Is he British? Is he German? Is he French? Is he a soldier? Is he a civilian? But because the son of the house is away in the Royal Air Force, they think, we'll take him in and hide him and look after him. And that's very dangerous. I mean, you could be killed, you could be shot, you know, taking that. And as he slowly recovers, when he wakes up, he speaks both English and German with equal fluency. So who is he? What is he? complicated by further, there's a recently arrived German officer who's arrived on the island, and how do I put this delicately, who's wanting to get his leg over one of the women. I'm very delicate, very delicate. And so he constantly appears. So they've got all this stuff going on, the relationships between the women, and because they all want different things, and this young man, and they're almost projecting onto him what they want him to be. One of them wants to be like an angel, and one thinks he's reminds of the sun, and one of the younger women almost as a potential lover. There are all sorts of things being projected on them, and it's an interesting story. And how do I say this? It reaches a very dramatic climax.
We like that. We like a dramatic
climax. Sounds exciting, doesn't it?
And, we've had a great team, as you know, the new venture. You've got a lot of people there. Yeah. It's amateur in the sense that it's not paid.
This is one of the key things, I think, to Brighton's performing scene. We have a lot of really great companies, and the word amateur no longer really applies. It's unpaid.
Yeah.
There was a little period of time, a couple of years ago, when a few companies decided they'd use the word unprofessional, which I think was misguided, totally, because these productions are incredibly professional. A lot of the people that you work with are, in fact, actors who have been on TV, in the West End, on tours, they are professional performers.
Absolutely. Designers, sound designers, all of that stuff. I think one of the worst insults you could give to a production, I remember somebody saying, it's very good for an amateur production. You could hear my teeth grinding in Vladivostok. It's either good or it's bad, you know, and the standard should be the same. Okay, some of the resources are not the same, but the standard should be the same. So, and I love this story. It's a fascinating story. So I thought, I'll give it a punt and see what we'll see what happens.
Well, let's have a look, because I think you've brought in a little clip that we can look at. If you could roll the VT, Adam, that would be lovely.
Drum roll. A little
it's a lovely promo. I mean, you talk about professionalism, that's very smart, very slick.
Yeah.
Is that also done by volunteers?
Yes, but again, as you say, people, I mean, the chap who actually did that is a professionally trained actor and does a lot of this sort of stuff. So you've got a lot of resources, you know, that you can call on. So and someone else, we've got a professional sound designer who does some of the audio for Doctor Who and stuff like that. But he will do stuff for us. In fact, he designed the sound for this, you know, and he's got a studio here in Brighton. So we're very fortunate, and people are prepared to do this and to offer this. And I was just looking at the young man in the promo there, of course, is someone that you've worked with, Jack Blinn.
Jack was in my play, in Brighton and in London. Yeah.
And
he only had a small part in it.
Oh dear, yes.
Don't quote him. Tell him that. I would have liked to have given him a bigger part, but that's another story entirely.
but Jack has to, of course, Jack has had to learn his lines also in German. There's an interesting interaction between some of the lines. As he recovers, he speaks most of the lines are in English in his explanation, but there's no interpretation, but it works, you know. And of course, he's had to learn German, and my German friend, she was coaching him, and she said to me, his accent is excellent, and you know, his inflections and stuff. So not easy to learn a script in a language that you don't know. But he's done well.
I've got some guests coming on later who will be talking about learning things in foreign languages, because the choir that he is the choir master for, they sing in all sorts of languages.
Especially Swedish, they're very good.
Including Swedish, which, frankly, it is a little bit like the Muppets watching them do the Swedish bits.
Well, I did hear them singing in Irish once, that was very good, so plug them too,
They get away with it, they're very good. We're going to go to a break now. When we come back, we'll be talking to Jo about her new show, which is for children.
Yes, it is, yeah.
Excellent. So, away from your former thrust of character.
It's not that far away.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'll tell you in a minute.
We'll go to a break. We'll see you after these ads. Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. My guests at the moment on the sofa are Jeremy Crudden and Joe Neary. Now, Joe, I've been watching you on stage for far too many years. I mean, more years than you've been alive, probably. And I remember you mainly back in the day as a character comic performer, and you invented all these wonderful, weird people. And you were actually very believable. I mean, sometimes it... We were never clear that it was Joe on the stage. It was just some random old lady who'd wandered in.
I'm not often myself on stage because I think I'm really boring in real life. So I think other people are interested. And those weird characters, most of them are based on real people from Brighton. So, yeah, I think real people are always much more, you know, inspiring and richer and complicated than I'm going to be a dumb hairdresser. Do you know what I mean? It's much more fun to base characters on real people, and then they are a bit weird, aren't they? But also relatable.
I said, yeah, absolutely. You sit there and you think, I've met this person.
Yeah.
Definitely met this person. And Brighton is famous for its weird characters. There's a wonderful lady who wears a fedora over a headscarf.
Oh, I don't know if I've seen her.
And dark Jackie O's. And she wandered into a friend's cafe one day and she said, do you do Bovril? And they said, yes, we do Bovril. She said, I'll have a Bovril frappe, please.
Oh, she sounds lovely.
She's fabulous.
Oh, she
fabulous.
Sounds
Now,
good.
You've got a new show.
Yes, I have.
What is this?
Yeah, well, a couple of years ago, I thought I'd like to have a go at doing children's shows. I think I saw some puppets in a show. I thought, that looks like fun, you know. How hard can that be? It's really hard, Andrew. So I made some puppets. They were terrible. Their eyes would drop out in front of the children. They would face the wrong way. And because I do comedy and I'm used to improvising and ad-libbing and doing jokes, I was kind of with the puppets, you know. So if they fell apart, I was still engaging with the children. And actually, the shows have ended up being, although they're children's shows, they're actually very, very close to my adult shows, do you know.
Just without the swearing.
Yeah, I never really did swear that much, but I've got characters in there, and also my quite dark sense of humour is in there, which the children really like, I'm pleased to say.
I think sometimes we misunderstand how much kids, especially modern kids, actually get.
Yeah, have you heard of Comedy for Kids? They're a lovely organisation.
Yes. Yeah.
And they said, if you come and do our show, don't change your material. I mean, obviously don't swear, but don't dumb it down. And that's what's happened. It's hard to describe, really. What makes you laugh and what you want to say is just as valid to a four-year-old as it is to a 34-year-old. You know, it's hard to describe, but it's interesting. I got some funding, you see, for these children's shows, to research and development money, so it wasn't that much money. And I thought, I'm going to end up researching and developing that these are not children's shows at all. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, it's me going, well, I meant to sing that song twice, I'm not doing that, it's boring, and the kids sort of nodding.
I mean, are you aware when you're performing to a children's audience that invariably they will be with their parents? Do you have to put in enough material so the adults enjoy themselves as well?
I do have some jokes for the adults. My favourite joke in the script, so I wrote this show with my friend Joseph Nixon, and he wrote a lovely joke in it where it's called The Crab Prince, and it's a story of based on the Frog Prince, you know, the traditional fairy tale. But it's a crab because we're by the seaside. So he comes out of the rock pools, he wants to be a human, but first of all he has to become a pet, then a child, then a human, because that's the way it works, isn't it?
It's a sort of Pinocchio story.
I suppose that is a bit, isn't
in
it?
A way.
Yeah, so, yeah, and I've forgotten your question. What was it you said?
Do you actually pay attention to the needs of the
parents? Oh, to the adults,
parents,
that's right, yeah. So there's a nice joke about Rick Stein in there, and after I did the show in Hangleton, a lady came up to me and she said, I'm not even with a child, but that joke for Rick Stein was for us, wasn't it? Thank you.
And of course, he'd be the demon king in a show about a crab.
Yeah, he was, exactly. You got it, you've got it.
Yeah. I love that idea. not that I've got anything against Rick Stein, I think he's marvellous.
Lovely fella.
It's fun to have a laugh at the people at the top, isn't it?
Yeah. Are you doing this at Comedia?
That's right, on the 2nd of November.
Which is sort of a home, really, for so many of Brighton's performers.
Yeah, well, it's a lovely venue. I love the Comedia, don't you? It's like a second home. I've been there so many times, I sort of swan about a bit, I'm ashamed to say. Do you know what I mean? Like, this is my second home.
Yes, I've been long here. Well, of course, the building that we filmed the show in here
was originally comedian.
I know. 94?
You must have performed here.
Yeah, definitely. I've definitely performed here. 94, was it, that Comedia came here? Do you remember?
I can't remember. Yes, around then. It was the early 90s.
I remember it well. Yes. It was exciting. Yeah. Proper good theatre with proper good stuff going on.
There was a lot of new theatre being commissioned and performed downstairs in the performance space. I mean, how do you feel about Brighton's performance spaces?
I think there could be more. Well, first of all, we're blessed.
You own your own stage.
Well, we're very lucky.
Well, you've got lovely theatre, lovely venture.
It takes a lot of money. It soaks a lot of money. We're talking about raising funds, and it's very difficult, especially in a listed building. But from the creative side, I mean, it's wonderful. You know, you just get this vibe when you come to Brighton and Hove, and there's all these little spaces and lots of creative people and lots of ideas going on.
The Marlborough,
love it. Lots of.
Is the Nightingale still going? Do you know?
It's called something else.
It's called something else, but it's still a working space.
Oh, good. That's a lovely space.
It's called something else. But there are lots of little sort of black box spaces, as you know. But it's who populates the spaces, which I think is even more important, because the city is full of very talented people, by the actors, directors, set designers, costume designers, singers. There's lots of people going on. And, of course, they're all very... my experience is they've all been very collaborative, you know. Yeah. But also nothing can shock anybody in Brighton.
No, you can get away with murder here.
Oh.
You can be shocked by bad stuff.
There's bad stuff around, and you think, why did I, like in The Fringe, I thought, why did I pay by £7.50 or whatever it was to see that, you know? But there was a story a few years ago, there was a play in the NVT called Hedwig and the Angry Inch. It was a sort of New York musical. And one of the chaps who played Hedwig, we had two Hedwigs, and this is a very big northern tough lad, but he had it. And we were about to do a little promo down a new road, and we did a little rehearsal beforehand, and we thought, why take the clothes off? He'll just walk down in his sort of
in costume.
And he said to me afterwards, he said he walked the whole way down Western Road.
No one batted an eyelid.
No one batted an eyelid.
That's what's so beautiful about Brighton, isn't it? It's lovely. I love it. I think that's why famous people can live here, isn't it?
There are places you would avoid doing that. I mean, I wouldn't go down the pier.
Go down West Street, at midnight,
You'd avoid those, but you can. I wouldn't call it getting away with Mary. You could just be who you are here.
Yeah.
I think that's right.
Fantastic.
And apparently that's always been the history of the city from very early on, because even before the Prince Regent and all of that, the area had this sort of...
Yes, there was an infamous duke who was known as the profligate duke who lived here around that time. Okay. And he was famous for his extravagant dressing and the way he... I think I've calmed down quite a lot from my... early days when I looked outrageous all the time and looking a bit country twins.
A bit more sober. Yeah.
It's funny though, isn't it? As you get older, I mean, as a woman getting older, I still wear the clothes I wore as an art student, but as you get to a certain age, you start to look like a bag woman.
It's very strange when you're 21, you can wear anything. The art student thing, because I've always said once an art student, you always dress like an art student.
Yeah.
So even though I'm wearing a tweed jacket today, I've got a pink jumper on with me because it wouldn't look right to me to wear it with a shirt and a tie.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm. And I think that I love that sort of whole art student look, though.
But even when you get older, I mean, there's that poem, I don't know who wrote it. I want about a woman, she's getting old, I want to grow old and wear purple. There's that poem. And there is a woman occasionally on the bus going down Western Road, and this lady, she's a fine, lovely-looking woman. She must be in her 80s. And she does wear purple, and she's so elegant, and she just sits there wearing purple. And I thought, you're marvellous. I don't never say it to her, but I think, maybe I should say to her, you are marvellous. Sits there with
style. I had a boyfriend, he said to me, I said, that girl, I love her dress. And he said, go and tell her. And I went, I can't. He went, go and tell her. So I went over and said, you look beautiful in your dress. And she was ever so pleased. I don't know if it might be difficult for a man going up to a woman saying the same thing. It might have a different connotation.
You've got to be careful.
Yeah. That's the way you say it, isn't it?
You've got to look after yourself, really.
Yeah.
You've got to be. But all the creative stuff, I mean, people like that are gravitate towards Brighton, you know, they just feel that they can do it and no one will...
Creative lemmings heading towards
Creative
the
lemmings, as long as we don't fall off the end of the pier, we're all right. Yeah. But
my whole show is Brighton-based creatives. It was fantastic working with Emma Edwards, director. Yes. From A&E Comedy, and she does the Moomin's children's show. Yeah. She's fantastic. Mm. Catherine Morton from Long Nose Puppets. Do you know Catherine?
Yes.
Incredible. She made my puppets the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. She brought the little girl in and she said, this is the daughter that, you know, this is what she would have looked like if you'd ever had a daughter. Mm. Yeah, fantastic. And, yeah, really great team of...
Now, when's your show on?
It's on in Comedia on the 3rd of November on a Sunday. I'm doing two shows and it's an interactive show because I thought I don't want the children to just be watching me for a long time.
That would terrify some people.
No, no, it's not in a terrifying way. What happens is the show all goes wrong and I have to save the day, so I ask them to all help me make puppets. So they all make a little puppet each and then they have their puppet in the audience to join in with the rest of the show. And if they don't want to do that, they don't have to. And if they do want to, they do. And when I did it in Hangleton, we ended up with all the children on stage with me bowing at the end because they were on the stage performing it with me. So the show sort of...
You're not going to be encouraging that new venture, are you?
We open on Friday night and we run for 8 performances. We're dark on Sunday and Monday nights, but we have a matinee on Sunday. And then we run through till... Saturday night, so it's
no show on Monday.
No show on Monday, and it's in the, as you were mentioning, the theatre upstairs, which we completely refurbished. Wonderful. It's lovely, lovely rake and wonderful new lighting system and sound system, and also, as you know, the new venture's got one of the cheapest bars in Brighton. You know,
even better, show. Even better.
Yeah, so.
Well, thank you both so much for coming in today. I hope both your productions go really well. I know I'm going to pop down and see Gabriel.
Thank
I might even try and pretend to be a 7-year-old and. Slip into Comedia to see your show as well, Joe. I'm sure a lot of my friends think that I am a 7-year-old anyway. We'll see you after these ads with more guests on the sofa. Look out! We're here for you. Hello, welcome back to Lookout with me, Andrew Kay. I've swapped my guests and I've brought in 3 new people. I have Scott, Stefan and Ben. Thank you all for coming in. All to very different things, but in some ways very related as well. Stefan, you are the choir master for Resound, which is one of Brighton's queer choirs.
Yes, that's correct.
And of course, Scott, you sing in the choir.
I do, yeah.
And I go along to all of your concerts and absolutely love what you do. They're
Thank
fantastic.
You.
But you're doing something very different this week in Brighton.
Yes, that's right.
So it's Resound is participating in an event called Outspoken, which is being put together by a small group of us, 6 of us in Brighton, who want to reach out and celebrate a pride organization in my hometown, in Parkersburg, West Virginia.
Right.
So the event is on the 12th of October, and it's going to be a bit of bluegrass, a bit of country and western music. We have a great award-winning folk singer going to be there, Naomi Bedford and Paul Simmons. And then we're going to have a fantastic new international premiere of a short film called Outspoken, which was made about Parkersburg Pride and gives people a little insight, I think, into what it's like to be LGBTQ in rural America.
Well, we'll take a little look at that later. Ben, you're here because your play is coming to the Marlborough. Really Want to Hurt Me. I read the title and I thought, I know that. I know how it feels, but I also know the song.
I'm glad to hear it. Yes, it sort of features several different 80s tracks, Culture Club, Tears for Fears, Kate Bush. But it's also, picking up on what you were saying about rural life, it's about growing up in a small town, a small town queer life in the 80s and the kind of experiences that a boy would go through at school, dealing with bullying, when there was a lot less access to LGBTQ imagery or awareness of what it's like to be gay. So it's a kind of rites of passage story about how feeling that isolated can really make you turn in on yourself and sort of internalise homophobia, but also how you can reach out to things like pop music, indie music, and to theatre, taking part in theatre, and sort of have a lifeline from that to kind of find your own identity. So it's sort of about 80s life specifically, but with a lot of references to LGBTQ lives today as well.
See, I was a teenager. Terrifying. In 1968 through to 1974, and pop music then had none of those queer icons to look to. We had some very bad examples. We had The Sweet with a very camp man saying I hadn't a clue what to do to the camera. We had Mark Bolan, who was very definitely heterosexual, but I would describe him these days as being non-binary, in a sense, a term that we never had then. And then, of course, you get to the 80s when I was that little bit older, but probably when you were a teenager, and all of those things were starting to surface. Boy George was there. There were all those references. I often thought at that point, though, maybe those would make you hide away because you'd be sitting watching Top of the Pops on a Thursday night and with your mum and dad eating your tea, and all of a sudden Boy George was on there and your dad saying, "Ooh, bloody puff," and all of this nonsense. And it would have been a very different experience, I think.
These are all things that are touched on in the play, that sort of fascination with this more progressive, subversive, be who you want to be world out there that you want to reach out to, particularly if you're not in a big city, but at the same time recoiling from it. So it's a sort of dark comedy, also has dance sequences to some of the music, but some of the comic material is about the boy writing a letter to Boy George, making a joke out of it, almost as though he's making fun of Boy George because he sees him as being a bit too much like that, but still really admiring him at the same time, that kind of push-pull fascination and not being sure who he is yet because he's being told by other kids in the playground that he's a puff, but he doesn't know what that is yet and he hasn't worked out who he is, which I think is something, you know, a lot of people have experienced and still experience. You're kind of put on the spot, the spotlight on you, before you get to work out who you are for yourself, because other people sense that there's something different as they see it about you.
Yeah, well, certainly something different about me. Now, I think we've got a little promo video clip that we can take a look at. Adam, can you roll the VT for Really Want to Hurt Me, please?
So here I am, Devon, 1984. The real 1984. When I get to the school gates, the terror in my guts sort of floods the rest of my insides, and I start drowning in it. I pull my bag closer to me, look down at the names of my favourite groups written in silver pen all over it. Tears for Fears, Eurythmics, Culture Club. I feel something in my heart. I can't control it. It's all murky red and dark and mysterious and wild, and is this what it's like being gay? I put my headphones on and I press play.
It's a terrific trailer. I love it because I love the music, particularly Sex Crime, which is one of those songs that I think I'd forgotten about until I watched that.
I know, and I never get sick of it. We have a big dance number, climactic dance number to that, and you just never get sick of the song. It just is timeless. And the actor in it, who's obviously much younger, just loves the music as well. It's kind of discovered all that Eurythmics.
How hard is it to write something which is clearly partly autobiographical, to watch someone else playing you on stage?
It kind of happened in a really organic way because it started as a short scratch piece in London. I was asked to write for a showcase. Then we got asked to do it at the Tristan Bates Theatre, slightly longer version. Then we got the Arts Council funding and developed it intensively. So we kind of had this synergy. I just hired the actor Ryan Price, who's brilliant, to do this short piece, so we didn't have great expectations, and I think that's the secret. You don't put too much pressure on yourselves, and bit by bit the piece comes together and you bounce drafts off of each other in a way, watching him doing pieces, then pare it down again to make sure you leave out stuff that nobody really needs to hear, you know, so that it relates to a really wide audience. And watching him, some friends who came to see it who I've mentioned in the show from the school friends said they felt like I'd picked somebody who was like a young me from back then.
They recognized
you. I didn't deliberately
you.
Do that, but apparently, subconsciously, somehow, there's a bit of me in him too.
You mentioned there were a wider audience. I mean, sometimes when I go and see theatre, which is clearly coming out of the LGBTQ plus community, that it's been written for the LGBTQ plus community, but these are stories that actually need a wider audience, because perhaps we're all aware of this. We know what's gone on, we know what's going on, and we know what needs to happen.
Yeah.
But it is that wider audience that needs to know more about the struggles in the past, the achievements that we have had.
And we think this story has been told already, but it hasn't. You know, there is still, like we have seen in our involvement with with Parkersburg Pride, that this is something we thought was in the past, but it's happening all the time. It's the same anxiety, and heaven forbid. I mean, I was lucky to grow up in a place like Sweden, which I think is on the whole
fairly liberal.
Yeah, I would say. But seeing what people are going through in a place like Parkersburg, it's extraordinary, really.
Yeah. I grew up in a tiny village outside a small town, outside Liverpool, and frankly, the only thing that we could do as teenagers was go to the church youth club, so our social life was based around the fact that you paid off by praying on Sundays, which was very odd.
Well, that's very much what this show is about for me as well. I think there's a lot of LGBTQ theatre that's about the cooler, slightly more grown-up, maybe still dealing with a lot of issues, community, but beyond that, really awkward young age and in a really small town, village almost, that this character's in. I felt important to tell that story. I don't think you hear it that often.
Well, let's talk more about being the only gay in the village after these ads. We'll come back in a few moments. We'll see you then. Look out!
The bright lights, they make me feel so free.
Look out. Look out. We're here for you.
Hello, welcome back to Look Out with me, Andrew Kay, and my guests Scott, Stefan and Ben. So we were talking about growing up in small places where there weren't the alternatives. I mean, when I got to London as an 18-year-old to go to art school, I was bewildered by the opportunities that I had never seen. I mean, it wasn't just the fact that there were bars that were gay, but there were cinemas showing foreign films. There were restaurants serving foreign food. I mean, you know, it was a whole different world. What was Parkersburg like as a young man?
Parkersburg actually had a really vibrant LGBT community going back to the 80s and before. Unfortunately, a lot of the jobs in that area were outsourced. So when highly paid jobs left, people left, and Parkersburg has lost about a third of its population since 1980. So where there were three gay bars, there aren't any now. And I think what has happened is that in Parkersburg, they've discovered over time that they're not the only gay in the village. They face some adversity, and even through this period where all of their meeting spaces have been decimated, they're finding their feet and they're coming together, and that's what we're celebrating on the 12th.
So how exactly are you going to be celebrating that this week? You've got musicians, performances.
Yes, we're using, I suppose in the first half, we'll be using music to kind of set the scene, to take, I mean, I've come to realise that lots of people don't know where West Virginia is, nevertheless, where Parkersburg is. And so we're using music to place people in Appalachia. Mm. We're using, it's going to be country and western, folk music, bluegrass, to kind of set the scene and draw people into this kind of culture. Mm-hmm. And Resound, lovely opportunity to sing Take Me Home Country Roads, which is going to be
well, fantastic. I was going to say, that's how most people will know West Virginia.
It's got to be done. And the Rebels are singing some Dixie Chicks, which is going to be great as well. And Naomi, this is just a potluck. I love Naomi Bedford, fantastic folk singer. She's the real thing. And if you don't mind me saying, she's just released a CD of Appalachian folk songs called Singing It All Back Home. And I thought, this is just meant to be. So we asked her and she said yes, and it's just been fantastic.
Have we got any Appalachian clog dancers? Because that is a big thing, isn't it?
It is a big thing. Yeah. It is. We don't have any on the night, but maybe if we do another event.
Well, Brighton had a very, very good Appalachian clog dancing team for many, many years when I first moved down here in the early 90s, and they were sensational. Yeah. I think I've heard of them for a long, long time now. Yeah, and frankly, it's 30 years ago, so probably most of them are like me, crumbling and walking with a stick. Tap dancing is not on the menu for me, that's for sure. But they were really good. I love that Appalachian music. I mean, I really like it. And
speaks
of course, a lot of it comes out of Scottish folk as well.
Absolutely.
It is that thing of I love that sort of troubadour tradition where music moves from one country to the next with moving states, immigration, and all of those things. I mean, you know, in many ways, the forced removal of people from one country to another is a bad thing. Yeah. But when you see how it influences creative arts, music, painting, theatre, that's always really, really exciting to see that thing. So out of adversity comes beauty.
Yeah. Indeed. And I think the music that you hit the nail on the head, that the music is a connection. And I think it's important to realise that we are all connected. Mm-hmm. And what we're trying to do, I think, with this event is to reach out from our relative comfort and relative security in Brighton to see and celebrate people in other parts of the world who, you know, who aren't in that position. So recognizing our privilege and helping other people in their struggle for rights.
Now, I know, Tom, you have a beautiful voice because I've heard you sing many times.
Thank you.
Was singing a great part of your childhood and the singing that you did as your childhood, were you actually singing the folk music of your region?
I did a little bit of that singing, but mostly classical stuff and singing in schools and in churches. But we did a little bit of bluegrass, a little bit of old Appalachian singing, some gospel sometimes. So a bit of a mixed bag.
I'm particularly fond of a very strange, peculiar American choral tradition, which is the golden harp singing, where they sing in a square?
Oh, I don't know that.
I don't know about that either.
I will have to play you some.
It's a newfangled thing.
It's extraordinary. It goes back a long, long way, and it's very strange, and it's sort of very unmusical, but in a sort of very beautiful way. I will introduce you to it later.
Yeah, I'll look forward to that.
I love that about the way music changes, and I love the fact that I grew up singing at school and singing in the choir and so on, and building that wealth of knowledge. I mean, was theatre part of your childhood?
Yes, and that's really a feature of this show. In a way, one of the strands of it is paying my dues to the teachers I had at school. I went to a very basic high school, quite a tough place, but it had the most amazing drama department, and that really kind of gave me that thread through. And joining local theatre, then touring with that, really helped me find myself. That's what this character does, finds himself instead of the fake self he's playing day by day by playing these parts.
Drama societies and drama courses are, in fact, the sanctuary of the adolescent homosexual in British schools, aren't they?
Exactly.
I mean, I know that. In fact, I did it as well. You felt safe when you were working with those people who were creative.
And broad-minded.
Broad-minded, yes. And a lot of your story is about name calling. My hate thing from being a teenager, I was known as one of the fairies from the bottom of the art room. And it was the mild end of it because there were so many horrible things that we were called. Mm. And getting over that. And now we can live in a society where we're sort of re-embracing that, having re-adopted the word queer.
Yeah.
And so on. Well, there are lots of other names that I wouldn't want to readopt.
Yeah, exactly.
It does tell a very strong part of that process of growing up, dealing with other people's attitudes to you, which is what pride is all about.
I think you need to see my show. Then we've got fairies in it, and him reclaiming the word fairy, by seeing an older student, drama student, who he can look up to and see a kind of future being gay that isn't what everyone else is telling him to be. But what it is still relevant to people now, obviously, that people are always coming up with new names to, you know, the herd likes to pick on the outsider and people are still dealing with these issues, sadly.
There's even demonisation of certain elements of the gay community within the gay community. I mean, you know, the oppressively butch element of the gay community being dismissive of the more effeminate element in the gay community. I'm thinking, you know, isn't it about time that, as well as achieving what we've achieved, we all internally say, it's fine, embrace your inner sissy. Yeah. You know, if you camp there, that's great. Just be it. Yeah. Be who you are and what you want to be.
I don't know, but, yeah, I certainly feel like a lot of the issues and the brilliant progress that is happening, despite all odds now, with trans and non-binary and gender-fluid identities, everyone has had their version of... I'm not collapsing everything together, but has had their own version of feeling, you know, closed down by gender when they were growing up. And it's not really relating to being, say, a man or whatever, but feeling there wasn't the language for to be something else.
We've been working with a lot of young adults from a local school over the past year, and it's just so invigorating to hear them talking about these things because they don't think it's an issue at all. Mm. They're not complaining because they just embrace it, you know. Mm. Such a body, well, he's non-binary or doesn't identify as being male or whatever. And to them, it's just, this is normal. Yeah. This is how life is, and it's all possible. It's all down to the hard work done, of course, by other generations over the years. Yeah. Unfortunately, some of the backlash that is coming out is from the older generations who don't seem to want to embrace these new terms and these new ways of living our lives that are so much better, so much more comfortable.
It's true, and I think it's important to recognise, though, here in the UK, that we have laws protecting LGBT people. Whereas in most of the country in the US, there are no laws protecting LGBT people from housing discrimination, from being sacked from a job for being gay. So you have this really weird situation where people are embracing themselves. In Parkersburg, people are coming together. They are being more visible. They can legally get married. But if you go into your job if you get married on a Saturday and go into your job on Monday and tell your employer what you've done, you can legally be fired.
You can be fired.
So, I mean...
And this is about, this is what we're showing in the second half of our concert on the 12th of October, with the event, we're showing a brand new documentary. It's a UK premiere of a film by Emily Harger, and that is showing the process they went through. What happens if the council votes down a bill of equality?
We've run out of time, sadly. Now, Parkersburg Pride is on the 12th, and so is Lily Want to Hurt Me on the 12th. You have decisions to make, and
at the Marlborough.
At the Marlborough.
Yep. And we're at the old courtroom.
You're at the old courtroom.
Yeah.
Two wonderful venues, two wonderful local venues here in Brighton, our beautiful Rainbow City. Thank you so much for coming in, boys.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. We'll be back in a week's time with four more guests on the sofa. But from this evening, it's good night from me. See you very soon. Look out. We're here for you. Goodbye.